watching that interview, ACT leader David Seymour. Tēnā koe, welcome to Q&A. Now, just for the record, Mr Boer indicated to us he was willing to appear here live to speak and debate with you, but you weren't prepared to do that. Why is that?
Oh, Jack, I've debated just about everyone and anyone up and down the country, literally from Kerikeri to Gore, in Parliament, out of Parliament, on TV. But I wasn't prepared to come on and go head-to-head with a guy who purports to represent the views of the Netherlands, when in actual fact, public opinion in the Netherlands, after 20 years of the law nearly, is 88% in favour, when the Royal Dutch Medical Association is heavily in favour of assisted dying laws after their experience of it. So I'm happy to come on and answer any points that he's raised, but I didn't want to go head-to-head with him tonight.
But let's talk about the points he raised. The number of people dying in the Netherlands by assisted suicide and euthanasia has been increasing. You don't contest that?
Oh, no. I mean, the statistics are very clear.
So why is that? Why are the numbers going up?
Well, I think it's natural that when something's new, not a lot of people are familiar with it. Maybe the systems are in place, the medical profession aren't there prepared to offer it. But eventually that does start to happen and more people take advantage of the law. But as you pointed out, it has actually started to level off in the last year or so.
But there's an important point that the Dr. Boer raises there, isn't there? He says effectively that is indicative of a normalisation of euthanasia or assisted dying, a normalisation that actually we don't necessarily want.
Well, I think what you've got to look at the numbers in the Netherlands is that for every 25 people who die in the Netherlands, 24 of them die without any kind of assisted dying. So the idea that when 1 in 25 people do something, that's normal, I think is not quite right.
What about the slippery slope argument that essentially by allowing people in New Zealand to die or to go through a process where they apply to die by assisted suicide if they are within 6 months of the end of their life, they have a terminal illness, it's insufferable. If we allow that, then in years to come, how can we say that we won't allow for other people, perhaps people who have a longer life expectancy or suffering mental health issues?
I guess it's always really difficult to argue against people who say, well, I'm not going to argue about what's on the table today, but I want to argue about some hypothetical other situation. Now, I think what's important is to look at the countries that have had these laws. And as you said in the earlier interview, Oregon's had the same law since 1998, I think it was. The Netherlands have had the same law since 2001, not 2002, and they haven't changed it. The Western Australians, as you mentioned, have looked into this in great detail, and actually there's not an evidential basis to say if we pass this law we'll end up with a different law. The countries that have passed assisted dying laws over 20 years have exactly the same law.
Can you foresee that though? From a philosophical perspective, can you foresee that change? If indeed your law passes through and is normalised to a certain degree, at least in a legal framework in New Zealand, can you see generations to come saying, you know what, we actually want to increase the access to this?
Yeah. Well, you could see them going either way, couldn't you? I mean, you could speculate endlessly. But what I would say is that, we've had a very robust debate here in New Zealand. Really, it started most recently. I mean, actually, it goes back to 1995 with the Michael Laws Bill. But it started most recently with the Lucretia Seals case in 2015. As I say, I've been up and down the country debating this. It's had the longest parliamentary process of any bill in Parliament I can think of. And after all of that debate, we've come to a pretty settled place where Parliament and the public seem at this point, and there's still some legislating to go, to be happy with a bill that is for people who are suffering at the end of their life, people who are terminal. And what people are saying is, if I'm suffering and there's no way that palliative care can help me, which is a reality for some people, then it's my life and it should be my choice. And I think a compassionate society would say to those people, you can have the choice, rather than requiring them to suffer on in order to satisfy the morality of others.
The debate continues this Wednesday in Parliament. What is your sense as to where your colleagues are sitting with this bill? What is the likelihood it will be passed anytime soon?
So we've had two of what will eventually be five committee stage debates. It's usually taking a night in Parliament to get through one of them, so there's another three to go. Translation, I think, will finish that process in October, and we'll have a third reading vote in November, just based on how it's going, but that can change. So far, members of Parliament have lined up about 70-50 in favour of the bill and making constructive changes to the bill while shooting down some of the more vexatious proposals that opponents have put up. So look, it's a grinding process, it's a long process, but so far, overwhelmingly, Parliament is voting for this bill to continue through. And I think that reflects that parliamentarians know that New Zealanders, 75% of them in TVNZ's poll have said that they actually do want this choice, and I think Parliament's starting to reflect that.
Well, no doubt we will speak on the subject again soon. Thanks for your time, David Seymour.